All right, folks. Thanks for the boys from Brooklyn for a great intro. The Beastie Boys with Sabotage from 1995. So just to get the juices flowing. And welcome everyone to MSP Talk, where we expand on topics relevant to an MSP or an IT reseller. But even though it's also relevant, what we don't do is talk about the SPs and feeds and the widgets and tools and everything. Even though it's very relevant, it's very important to your service delivery. All right. 2 months ago, I had a guest on to discuss the steady increase in M&As in the MSP world, right? And I had already prepared. I knew I wanted to expand on it with the second segment, even though a third, maybe sometime. My guest on a couple of months ago was Reed Warren from IT Valuation. It's my pleasure to welcome him aboard. Let me click on him. How you doing, Reed?
Hey, how you doing, Michael? Great to be back. Love the last one too. It's a great conversation.
Yeah, is that your cup of tea? What's your think about who you'd like to hear next time I bring you on board, right?
Who I'd like to hear? The Beastie Boys are really good. If you want to do a full virtual concert with them, that'd be great. So
okay. Well, I'll put it on the list of things that we can get together with the MSP Talk, right?
Yeah.
All right. So listen, welcome aboard. Reed's in Minneapolis, and I'm in Laval. Quebec, and if you're noticing the background, the blank background is just basically due to COVID. Some of the conference rooms are taken or basically unavailable, so they stuck me in a closet. So that's hence the blank space in the back. All right, so listen, I just wanted to. Last time we spoke, Reed, we spoke about the key elements, motivational factors, risk and rewards, and what makes it a fit for any merger, acquisition, resale, anything like that. Now I just wanted to take us to take a look at preparation, right?
Awesome.
Specifically in the sub 2 million, even sub $1 million category, right? And from our earlier discussion, you told me you don't necessarily get involved in such acquisitions as basically because the fees just make it so that it's not a good return. And however, I want you to talk about this aspect. But before we dive into that, just basically present a bit more about IT Valuation. Give me the elevator pitch on your business and what you do.
Hey, great. Hey, really appreciate it. The IT Valuation spent 12 years doing valuations, mergers, and acquisitions. Here at IT Valuations, we've launched IT Valuations a little over 2 years ago, kind of with that background. Right now, we're a team of four people. We've got two business analysts on the team with us, as well as a support person. And then we have a couple of independent contractors that we plug and play accordingly, just as the needs arrive, whether it's additional financial analytics work, or if we do research work or some of the other pieces as well. And then we have a partnership, really critical partnership that we have with for all of our M&A. And that's really, we have a partnership with a law firm that Virtus Law here in Minneapolis, done a lot of transactions with them, and they have a legal as a service model, which has been really great for MSPs. They probably half their work is with MSPs. So again, if you're looking for a lawyer that understands the space well, a great partner with us. So.
So basically, you just described, I'm actually doing something in the next couple of months on outsourcing. So that's exactly what you just described, right? You found some partners to be able to help you grow what you're doing. And just before we dive into, I address the fact that there's an increased number of mergers and acquisitions. And maybe just give me a couple of, not numbers, but percentage of growth this year that you've experienced versus last year.
Yeah, so a couple of different ways to look at that. One, the velocity of transactions is actually up this year, and it's 2021 is actually looking stronger than that. A number of reasons for that. Just in short, the PPP funds here in North America anyways, or U.S., really put cash on the balance sheets for a lot of smaller companies that now are looking to do acquisitions. So that's driving it. The other thing that happened is through COVID, the IT industry did really, really well overall, comparatively really, really well, right? And as a result of that, we just see a massive amount of private equity funds coming into the market looking to do acquisitions because it's being viewed as relatively a safe haven compared to other industries. And so because of that, we're just really seeing the number of transactions getting done. It's kept the valuations, I don't want to say inflated, but it's supported supported them. They really haven't gone down. The terms, which would be the other thing that I had really expected to see pivot in 2020, moving more to earnout models to de-risk the situation. They've actually stayed pretty constant with roughly 60% of the transactions will be cash at close to 40% in an earnout. Usually that'll be reverse of that. It's pretty common to see the reverse of that. And then the sub $2 million market, sub $1 million market, we're probably seeing 50-50 kind of cash and earnout type model. So we'll get more into that today on cool. Some of the things on readiness, because, for a seller, you're trying to not have any more earnout than you have to. And there's ways to position yourself accordingly.
Oh, okay. That's cool. All right. So the first segment, before I get started, just like if anybody has any questions or anything as we go on, write it in the chat box for sure. I mean, no problem. This isn't scripted. I'm going to shoot out some questions, but the questions can come from you. No problem. So first part, basically, let's look at the buyers, right? Let's look at the, at this point, let's say the buyer knows what he wants. Okay. And knows what he wants to get out of the transaction and why. Right. Okay. But what's the first step? Okay. So you walk us through it.
Yeah. I think there's two things I like to remind buyers when they get into it. A lot of people go, "Hey, I've got money. I should go buy something." I think.
That's my girlfriend. That's Julie. Julie, don't listen to him. Okay. It doesn't mean that. Anyway, go ahead.
But I think the reality is this is what we see consistently time and time again is that the seller is going to represent the buyer within 12 to 18 months. And the question I like to ask the buyers is are you a model worth following, right? So the reality is this, if you're not, if you're 10%, if you're 5% of it, you say you have an average EBITDA, which is right now about 6.3%. So if you have an average EBITDA of 6.3% and you're growing 5% year over year and you go buy something, if you buy somebody that's at 15% EBITDA growing at 30% year over year, guess what? It's going to turn into you in 12 to 18 months. So the first thing I like to remind our buyers is you have to be kind of that model company or a model better than the company you're buying. Otherwise, you're going to take what you've bought and you're going to depreciate the value of it. Conversely, if you are if you have a 15% EBITDA growing at 20% year over year, the cool thing for you as the buyer is you can buy an average MSP firm and it's going to resemble you in 12 to 18 months and you're going to get the lift of that as the buyer. And so, the first question I like to ask really is, are you a model for what you want the seller to become?
Okay. So you want to be able to do for the seller to properly represent you, he has right. to be, you have to be coming with something that's a benefit to, all right. And you're able to draw some benefits out of the operations of the seller.
Right. And so I would just say there's times that people come from a buyer perspective saying, hey, I'm hoping to buy somebody with, hey, this stall stuff put together that I don't have put together. It's really hard to actually, it's a cultural shift for you to do that. And so typically the seller comes in going, hey, I'm going to emulate you, the buyer here. And you've got to be emulatable if that's a word.
Okay. I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't know.
I think the other element to that too is just really be, as with any acquisition, it typically costs you more than you expect, right? And so you do want to make sure you have funding. You do want to make sure you have margin. I've been a part of a lot of leveraged and highly leveraged buyouts. Those just put a lot of risk into it. And so as much as you may have, it's kind of like buying a home. As much as the bank may say, hey, you can borrow, 40% of, your income. The reality is you're probably better off doing something smaller than that, just so that you have the bandwidth to make sure everything goes well. And so again, it's about finding something that fits well. You can generally, as a rule, buy up to 50% of your size and assimilate that well and afford that well. Probably more realistically, if you're looking at something a third your size, you're probably in that place that says, hey, I can do it. I've got margin. If things go a little bit sideways, I have the capacity to do it without putting everything at risk.
So let's put aside the financial aspect for now. It's all about financials, but I figure, let's say, for example, someone comes to you and says, okay, I want to buy out a company, right? What are the red flags that you are going to look at to tell them you're not ready, or, right. Operational maturity, like sometimes you want to buy, but then you look at the business model of the buyer that's coming to you and you say, listen, right. You don't have the horsepower. You can't take it on. What are the types of red flags? What are you looking for to this, not to disqualify or discredit, but to basically make sure that they're going into this and it's going to be a success?
Right. So from the buy side, you want to make sure that you have good, efficient processes. You have capacity on your team to be able to pick up extra loads. So your point, having good operational maturity, I would also tell you just have a good organic growth strategy, right? If you don't have that, it's hard to buy somebody who does, right? And so again, from a buyer side, it's about operational preparedness. It's about financial preparedness. It's about directional, I'm going to call it go-to-market preparedness, knowing where you're going, how you're getting there, why you're getting there. And then I would also talk about it from a leadership perspective that says you have to have leadership capacity. One of the things I see a lot of buyers coming in doing, it's like, hey, the CEO's been the kind of chief cook and bottle washer, really runs everything, and it's very hands-on, is already working 60 hours a week. You don't have any emotional, physical capacity to take on an acquisition, because it's going to easily put 20 to 30 hours a week onto your plate. And you just, so you really need to be a place as a leader. If I'm the CEO of a $2 million firm buying a $1 million firm, before doing an acquisition as the CEO, you really need to be the place where your team has clear clarity on what they're doing, where they're going, how to operate. You have at least 20 hours a week that you can carve out and give without sacrificing family time to be able to make sure it gets integrated and the whole bolt in comes in well. So you have to have that kind of capacity as a buyer.
So just like, basically, does it put you in a bind when let's say, okay, buyer comes out and he's first meetings you have with him or discovery chats that you have with them, and you come to that realization, put you in one spot to tell him, listen, man, sorry, but you don't have the leadership maturity to be able to take that on, right?
Yeah, I would just say that most buyers that come to us, as much as they come and say, hey, I've got money, I want to go, let's go, let's go, let's go. Usually there's oftentimes a good 2-3 month just delay of, hey, just getting my ducks in row. Because when you talk through the load that it's going to put on your team and the load that it's going to put on yourself and the load that's going to put on your financials, you really want to make sure that you have those things in order and that you have capacity and you have your own house in order before moving into taking over a new property in that sense.
All right, that's good. All right, so listen, I mean, that's great. I mean, let's dive into a bit more complex, not as complex, but it's from the seller's perspective.
Right? Sure.
So again, got any questions, type them in. So basically, okay, if you want out, right, you're a seller, either you're looking to merge because you don't want to manage and you want to be able to have some growth and maybe for a couple of years and have a plan in place to get out, or you basically want to get out immediately or in 2 years or something like that. What are the first steps as, when I realize I want to get out, okay? Now, what goes through an owner's, what's their first step to look at?
Yeah, I think, first of all, I'm going to talk about, you always got to sell into something, right? And so if you're selling, you're either going to sell into the new organization that's by you, or you got to have a path into something that you're going to do. The big reason for this, I'm going to call it seller depression, that happens afterwards. For most MSPs, the owners sold something. I was talking to a gentleman this morning out of the Boston area. He spent 30 years in his business. It's about a $1 million firm, and he's looking to sell. He's 66 years old, and there's a fatigue point. There's a number of things coming together. The reality is, for somebody who's invested like that, and that's similar to a lot of our listeners, it's been your blood, sweat, and tears. And so it's become very much a part of your identity, and you actually have to kind of work through that. As a lot of people now I'll go, golfing or whatever. You have to have more in life than that. You'll find that golfing gets boring pretty quickly. Sailing gets boring really quickly. I've heard people want to sail around the world, right? But the point is this, you got to sell into something. And so you do have to have a plan for what you're going to do post-transaction. If it's not into the seller or into the buyer and working with them for a period of time, you have to have a very clear plan that's going to drive meaning and value in your life. Otherwise, you're going to really wrestle with the hard part of it is that in a transaction like that, the emotional feeling that you're going to have afterwards is, I've sold my identity. I've really kind of sold myself.
I've been working for 30 years. Yeah. That was my identity. That was my reason for getting up in the morning. So that part goes into play.
And it's way deeper than just, hey, I'm retiring, right? Because people can usually get through the idea of like, hey, I've worked hard, now I'm going to retire. And so if you've been an employee for a long time, you look at retiring, hey, you know, that's the next step. With an owner, it really is a much deeper emotional struggle and psychological struggle. And so I just coming back to it, it says you really have to have a plan for that, for what you're going to move into and where you're going to go with it in some way that contributes back to your family, to the, you know, those that you hold close, and that are going to contribute into your life, someone who's invested in your life. Okay. So that's probably the first piece. And then the second, you know, coming behind that, when you look about getting ready, too many people come similar to buyers, but sellers are going to come and say, okay, I've had it. I'm ready. I'm done. I got to get out. Right. That's actually one of the worst positions to actually sell your firm in.
Sure.
Because there's a level of desperation. There's a level of fatigue. And so you really need a number of things to come together really nicely to drive an optimum value. When we come in, we usually do we call it a value gap analysis, and we take a look at your current value, your potential value, and what are the steps to actually get there. For most firms, on average, there's a 27% value gap. In other words, 27% less value that you're going to take as a seller, because candidly, you're not really ready and have it all geared up. So to put that into numbers, if you had, let's say a $2 million firm, or say $1 million firm for that matter, and it was valued, had a potential value of $1 million, you're probably sitting at about $750,000 is the max you're gonna get. So you're leaving $250,000 on the table. You know, obviously as you scale up, you know, it becomes, you know, twice that, you know, if you're a $2 million firm. And so for a lot of those reasons, we want to take a look. We want to not only position you for an optimum sale value, but also, you know, the other thing is the greater the risks in the transaction, the more there's going to be an earnout. And that kind of comes back to our earlier point that says, hey, there's things that you need to put in place if you want to walk away sooner. The expectation for most buyers, and should be for you as sellers, that even if you've got things positioned really well, you're probably in it for a year before you can exit. For most sellers, it's a 3-year run. It just because it takes that
3
long.
3-year, yeah.
Takes you. Now, conversely, there's two things, and this gets into the conversation. I can acknowledge that it's going to take 3 years and just ride along, or you can take 1 to 2 years and position the business, but you're still, either way, you're going to be in it for a 3-year period, because you'll get everything ready in 2 years, and then you're still going to hang on for a year in the transaction. So when you come to the place that says, hey, I'm really ready to sell, understand you still have 3 years left to run before you can usually get clean without taking a pretty significant hit on your value.
Okay. Let's say, well, that's more like a retirement scenario. Right. Or semi-retirement scenario, because you can sell your business at 50. There's no way in hell you're going to retire, right?
Right.
You're going to start doing something else. What if a guy, I don't know, someone has built a business, I don't know, that's 700K, 650, 700 to $1 million, just doesn't have necessarily the drive to lead. Isn't that attractive to that? But hey, it could be like 45 years old and still wants to work in the biz. Now, the timeline is a bit different, right? Because you're already set up mentally that you say, you know what, I want to be able to get some value out of this, but keep working.
Yeah. Well, that's definitely the second main reason we see people sell. Obviously, one is fatigue and I need to be done and get out. But certainly for, you know, we see 35 on the young side to, you know, the early to mid 40s looking at an acquisition. A lot of that is that, hey, I started out as a technologist. I love being a technologist. Now I've got to do payroll and I got to do accounting and PEO and I got to do sales. And I just want to work on technology, right? And that's a very, very powerful motivation. And quite candidly, a lot of buyers are looking for people like that, where it's like, hey, good tech. So we've got a couple of transactions actually we're working on from that perspective, where the buyer's saying, hey, I want an owner-minded, really kind of CTO kind of guy who understands owning a business, running a business, but really can speak to it from a technology perspective. And so we have a number of buyers that are looking for companies that are in that, you know, $1 million space with strong technology leads, who really are kind of tired of doing the back office type pieces and are looking to be a part of something bigger and give them a long run. And those are usually a great win-win situation, because now you get to, if you're the seller, you get to offload what you don't like doing. Usually those buyers have the rest of that infrastructure in place. They have the accountants, the CPAs, the bookkeepers, the sales team, and you get to do really what you love doing, which is usually interfacing well with the customer, solving their technology problems, and putting together a great long-term solution for them. And we still see a shortage of talent within the IT sector. And so again, in those cases, we're usually seeing very little turnover on the executive level and even on the team delivery levels. And it's usually works pretty good from an integration. I think that's one of the main things we're seeing post-COVID is a lot of companies are realizing, hey, there is a certain element to critical mass, right? That just says, I can keep running the risks as an owner of a small firm and be really challenged with that, or I can sell and become a part of a $10 million firm, do what I love doing, and all the weight of it's not sitting on my shoulders and I'm not worrying about how to make payroll.
Yeah, no, those are definitely different. Those are emotional drivers. They have to do a lot with introspection, right? It gets to be, it's not that it's complex. I think it has to do with a lot more of stepping back and a certain maturity as a business owner to realize that, you know what, I can't do it all. Listen, I have these discussions, of course, like MicroRage is a franchise. It's a bit of the same type of discussions that we have is I'm talking to business owners because we have, like, MicroRage is a conversion franchise as opposed to a startup model that a lot of people equate with franchises. It pops up in a new business. It's not the case with us. So basically, I'm talking to business owners that are at a certain point where, you know what, they're probably very good at what they do, but there are certain things that are in the blind spot. They have some blind spots and that they might actually need some help, and they might have, we can have different pieces that bring to the table. So you mentioned earlier, being part of something a bit bigger, that way you're able to thrive and not have to worry about so many different aspects that a business owner of a small company has to worry. And, smaller, bigger company, it doesn't matter. Unless you actually get a mature operational structure where you have people in place that basically are your collaborators, until you get to that point, it weighs heavy on your shoulders, right?
Well, and I really love what MicroRage has done and the model you guys have. And that really kind of, if it's a nice middle piece too, where you have people that are like, hey, I like running things, but I realize I'm not the greatest at everything, right? And so I would say part of good leadership is self-awareness. And we talk a lot about outsourcing things, but one of the things I like about the MicroRage model is it allows you to come into an organization, get a lot of support from the marketing and the sales, and hey, I can learn from the peers. Things have been figured out. I don't have to solve every problem, but I still, as the owner of the franchise, I still have a lot of the executive levels leadership. I'm not getting displaced from that. you still are. And so it really is this nice hybrid, I'm going to call it a hybrid solution as a business owner to say the weight's not all on my shoulders. I have a lot of support to help me carry it. At the same time, I still get to be, the key guy. You guys still got to run the operation of the business, right? So you're still there, but there's a lot of support that's going to be able to go with you through it. You have a forum really in a community in which you can solve all your technical problems with, and there's just a lot of good stuff that happens with it. So I really like what you've built there at MicroRage, if anybody wants my opinion on it, if you're going, hey, I don't really want to sell and become just a CTO, I still kind of want to be my owner, but I want something off, some of the risk off my place and some support and community.
There you go. Yeah.
This is actually a really good, solution for you in a really good environment to be able to work in.
Thanks. I like the way you position it. Basically, at the end of the day, it's about being able to take some weight off your shoulders, right? And it's not that we're a hybrid model. It's basically a way to have your cake and eat it too, right?
Right.
We're always looking for that, something like that, right? Anyways, so listen. Okay, we talked real quick about the you mentioned something earlier in discussions that the preparedness of it. Okay, so I'm ready to go. Emotionally, I'm ready. Financially, I'm okay. The 3-year bid is fine for me. As an owner, I'm saying, okay, where do I start? What's my first step, right? Once I'm ready to go. Getting my financials in order, beefing up some of the aspects of my business, cleaning up. What would be a first step, right?
Yeah, so good, really good question. And so, you're in Canada and French chefs are some of the best chefs in the world. Think of it in the context of a little bit of like a restaurant that just says, hey, you're a great cook, right? You've got people come from all over the place because they love the food that you mm-hmm. make. Here's the reality. Unless you have it down to recipes and unless you have a logistics process for making sure you have the right fresh ingredients at the right time to do it, it's just you. Right. And so in the end, when we look at getting ready, so much of it is you got to take your secret sauce that you've built, your methodologies and your process, and you actually have to document them and structure them. The degree to which and so we talk about enterprise value. Enterprise value is the assets and the economic benefit stream or the profitability okay. that's sustainable and transferable. So the degree to which it's not sustainable and the degree to which it's not transferable to a buyer is going to depreciate the value of your business. That's really, let me just put that now into layman terms. Because what does that mean? That means I have to have defined process. I have to have it mapped out. I need to be able to say, hey, here's the recipe book.
Okay.
Here's how we do onboarding. Here's how we do invoicing. Here's how we do all the different aspects of it. Here's our go-to-market strategy.
So what you're saying is basically, one of the things you're saying is that it has to be defined. It has to be written down. If it's basically ad hoc, where a buyer comes to me and says, okay, I need to look at your books. Books tell a story. Fine. That's one thing. But however, if I want to be able to integrate that into my business, it doesn't have to be an identical process.
Right.
What you're saying is that it has to be documented.
It has to be documented. If you say, well, I don't know how it happens to Steve, he's a wonderful technologist guy. I don't know. He takes care of all the problems. Well, that's not scalable. And now we've got a problem. What happens if Steve leaves? And so now Steve's a risk, right? Where if I say,
same goes with a sales rep, right?
Right.
You've got a kick-ass. Sorry. You got a great sales rep and he does his thing. And you're basically as an owner, maybe you're out, you just get out of the way to make sure that he's, he's selling. Right. But then you try to replicate what he does. You can't, right?
Okay. So when we talk about, for the seller who goes, okay, I'm ready. I'm emotionally, we're doing that. There's a couple of really key elements that you got to do it. We're going to take a look at it first from a financial, legal, and operational. Those are the three main buckets that you fall into. Okay. From a financial, your financials tell a story. And so most people's financials are pretty messy. It's really about really clearly over the last 3 years, at least, making sure that you've accounted for things the same way. I'd also say call out your owner discretionary expenses, right? And so those would be, hey, for meals, entertainment, travel, although you're not doing much in travel these days, but calling those out. If I have a vehicle on the books, if I home telephones, home systems, cell phones, family members, there's all sorts of things that are normalizations that you as an owner, hey, they're discretionary, right? There's nothing wrong with doing it. It's just the fact that, hey, this once a transaction happens, that's going to stop, right? And so as a result, because it's going to stop, you now get to add that back to your profitability. So going through a process of just making sure it's just not your word, some other account can sit down with your books and can go, oh yeah, okay, so the owners, here in Minnesota, they bought Viking tickets. Why you'd buy Viking season tickets, I don't know. We won't go down that path.
You opened the door. I can talk about it the whole segment. Anyways, go ahead.
Yeah, we've got at least 40 years of disappointment from the Minnesota Vikings of never getting to the Super Bowl. But besides that point, the point is this. Hey, that can be a legitimate business expense if you use it for marketing purpose, but this is much for the owner as is for the customer, right? In the end. And so we can look and then go, well, that's that, whatever that price is, 20 grand a year. That's a seller discretionary expense. So obviously you want to call that out so that it's clear.
Correct me if I'm wrong. I think it's more for the buyer to be able to take that out easily without forensic analysis and getting the third degree in terms of questioning, right? I think that's more to be able to say, oh, you know what? It's a given. I understand. Okay, that piece is out. Now I get it. That means that I don't have to factor it in.
Right. And so the clearer it is, and particularly, things like meals and entertainment and travel, that's probably the place that gets most blended. You just can't say, well, half of that's mine and half of it's the company.
Okay.
Because then the buyer's going to go, well, do I really know it's half? I'm really not going to give you credit for half. So if you put it and you call it out and just create a section on your P&L called seller or owner discretionary expenses, and you can break some of that stuff out, that makes it really clear. Then the buyer goes, oh, wow, okay, that's going to disappear. We're good, right? So being really articulate on that, I'm going to I know it's a big lift for small companies to be GAAP compliant. So I'm not saying you have to be GAAP compliant, but there's a number of things that you should really consider that'll become factors for you or places that it's going to decrease the value of your business. One of those is deferred revenue. So if you sell an annual contract, you actually can't recognize all of that revenue in the month that you sold it, right? And so a lot of people are like, yeah, you know, I've got customers, they're on, that's good MRR, they pay for a year at a time. And so, you know, Bob's auto shop, you know, down the way paid for a year last month. Well, actually that revenue needs to be applied every month. And so having good deferred revenue, otherwise what'll happen is you're going to, I'm not going to go any further on the weeds on that, but you can talk to your CPA about having deferred revenue, good accounting along those lines. The other element that you're really going to want to do on that is really have good revenue breakouts. The buyer really wants to know, be able to slice the revenue breakout. So that's going to be revenue by customer. That's going to be revenue by service offering. And when I talk about it, it's not just revenue, it's really revenue and gross margin. Yeah. So you know the gross margin that you have on every service line that you have in your business. So whether that's product sales, whether that's service sales, whether that's project sales, project work that you're going to be doing, you want to be able to break out revenue and profitability by those amounts. You also want to be able to take a look at your vendors and say, hey, data, we sell this much of data, we sell this much of Microsoft, we sell, and this is our margins on each of those items. So being able to slice and dice your revenue and gross margin from a top line level is going to be invaluable.
Okay. So basically, that's the biggest key to get your house in order is has to do to have clear, defined financials with the KPIs that they need to really have to break it down.
Yes. The other one other thing I just touch on the financials because this is a place where people lose a lot of money, sellers especially. Okay. And that is working capital. Most businesses have more cash in the business than is needed to operate the business. And so you need to really take a look at that. I've had clients that have literally millions of dollars on their cash in the balance sheet because they don't want to take a loan. Hey, I love the fact you don't want to take a loan, but you don't need to have $2 million sitting on your balance sheet in the banks as a $2 million MSP. Because you're not using that much cash. The reason for saying that is whenever we get into a transaction, the cash on the balance sheet always becomes a point of negotiation as how much is needed in the business to run the business. Okay. And so as a general rule, you should have 50% more current assets and current liabilities. Happy to go deeper in that. But basically, when you look at your receivables, AR, and your cash, they need to be, 50% greater than your payables and your current liabilities should be credit cards, things like that. That's generally a rule of thumb. The reason for that is most people are a lot of companies are operating at higher than that, and that's your money, right? Quite candidly. And so, one of the things that we work with sellers on, we talk about getting ready, is we take a look at what is the required working capital. It can be way more complicated than that, but the point is this: if most of the time when we take a company to market, we're going to tell them, "Hey, look, you've got $500,000 of excess cash in the business. Pull that out now, so that the buyer doesn't try to fight you for it, and you end up losing that." Because there's a lot of ways to lose that.
You do that the year before, or can it be something that basically within the same fiscal year that you're actually entertaining a sale? Or
you can do it at any point. End of the year is actually the best point. So we're coming up on the end of the year, taking a look at that and just going, hey. So if you talk to your CPA, just ask them about, hey, having a current ratio of 1.5. You may not understand what that means, but your CPA does, and he can help you work through that and go, okay, wow. All right. That's just an easy way to make sure you're not leaving money on the table for somebody else to take.
Okay. And what if, so just basically boil it down. How is it a point of contention? All of a sudden the buyer comes in, there's too much money on the books, and how does it derail the process? How does it hurt it?
Well, there's a lot of factors that weigh into working capital. And if, so you can take 10 CPAs and you ask them how to calculate working capital, you get 20 different answers, right? So there's a lot of ways to do it. But one of the things we see most common is we'll see where they'll say, hey, your working capital needs to be similar to what you've had for the last 6 months. Well, it sounds pretty reasonable. And you go, well, yeah, okay, it's last 6 months, it's been there. Yeah, but if you've had it at extra cash in it, you just agreed at the letter of intent stage that you're going to leave all the extra working capital in it. There's other risk factors that can be applied to it. And all I'm saying is, if you go into a transaction, even at the 1.5, it's still going to be a negotiation. The point of it is, it's a lot harder for the buyer to say you need to put money back into it than for them to say, I'm not going to let you take the money out, right? And so one of the things that happens, and it's really important for sellers that you know this, once you enter into a letter of intent, the financials are no longer yours, right? And it's not that you don't continue to operate the business, but it's kind of like dating. Okay, I got engaged. I can't go out and buy that Porsche without telling my, fiance that, you know, hey, I just bought a new car, right? She's going to be a little panicked if, she wants to be included in those decisions, right? So think about that in the context of a yep. buyer. Once you become engaged, you have signed a letter of intent. The reality is there's going to be this transparency. Yep. Somebody else is going to be looking at that, looking over your shoulder. And so it's too late to be able to make any major adjustments like that. So you'll want to make those adjustments prior to signing a letter of intent. And again, it's going to, in short, and I don't want to make this a complicated conversation, but in short, they're going to look at your receivables. They're going to look at your payables. They're going to take a look at your inventory turn. They're going to take a look at labor inventory turn. And all of those things come to, hey, here's the amount of cash that we have. In short, the best way to shorten your required working capital is low receivables. So yeah, have your receivables in 15 days. Set it up so that people prepay for the service. Most customers are getting pretty used to that. Do electronic, whether it's Connect Boost or something else, do automated billing for them so you could pull from a credit card or ACH rather than running checks. Everything you do to shorten your AAR timeframe is going to improve your cash flow, and it's going to reduce the amount of working capital you need at close. The other, leaving the business, the other element to it is a lot of people are pretty proud about paying their bills on time, and they have a really, really low payables. I don't want to digress into this too, but the reality is this: having a healthy payables is a good thing. Paying your payables within 15, 20 days rather than immediately actually improves your cash flow and improves your working capital situation. So it's not that I'm saying, hey, don't pay your vendors and slow pay them. I'm just saying a healthy payable period is going to help you out as a business owner, improve your cash flow. And then when it comes to doing a transaction, it's actually going to help you on your working capital calculation.
Listen, yeah, there's so many things that go into play. You mentioned like Connect Booster, automated pay. I mean, that's not something that you decide like, okay, I'm ready to sell, so now I can make those changes. Those are the types of changes that you have to envision six right. to 12 months beforehand, right? I mean, talk about reducing your AR, your right. accounts receivable, and shortening the pay cycle. That's like, it's kind of like a grinding process, unless you're right. able to turn the switch off to your customer and say, hey, you know what? Right. You know what? If you don't pay me next week, you're off. But that's not a fun conversation to have, right? Right. So what you're describing has more to do with there's the short-term preparation.
Right.
There's and there's also like long, like right. looking down the road, right?
Right. Well, in short, not to beat up on working capital, but it's a place a lot of discussion. If you move to an automated system and you take your receivable from 30 days on average to 15 days on average, most working capital is what is the expenses of the business for a period of time. And so if I'm going to say cash conversion cycle, that people are going to get lost in that. I don't want to get people lost on it. But if that period of time is 30 days, that means you're going to take your operating expenses and your cost of goods sold, and you're going to multiply it by 30 days.
Okay.
So you figure out your daily cost to run the business, you multiply it by 30 days. If you do a better job of doing receivables, so now you have a 15-day turn, well, guess what? You know, if you could cut your working capital requirement in half by having good receivables and improving your payables slightly, right? Payables turn. So, anyways, that's feel free. You can send me emails. Yeah. I'm going to get into a conversation and get into the weeds more with you on that. But that's a really important thing that people don't realize. That it's like, hey, well, I have some companies that slow pay. Hey, if they slow pay and it's 60 days out, yes, that will negatively impact your transaction volume.
All right. Okay, cool. And so, in terms of, we looked at the financial real quick. Hey, listen, yeah. In terms of legal.
Right? Yeah, legal.
The fun part.
Yeah, legal. I love my lawyers. Legal is a challenge, right? Because so there's a couple things I'm just going to talk about in the best practice conversation, right? A lot of first of all, when you come to a transaction, every document you've ever signed in the history of business is going to be up for display. That's a lot, right? And people are like, yeah, well, I've had some of these clients for 40 years or 20 years, and I mean, we signed some at the beginning. I don't know where it is. Well, every contract that you can't point to, there's two reasons for doing it. One is to assure, hey, you know, is the customer going to continue to buy? That's one thing. A lot of people go, well, they've been buying for 20 years. What makes you think they're going to leave? Well, that's not the issue. The secondary issue is liability. What sort of promises or guarantees or assurances have you provided the customer that the buyer is now going to be responsible for once the transaction occurs? And if you don't have an agreement in place, then basically you induce a lot of risk, not only from a will they continue perspective, which you can argue, and we argue that a lot, but hey, what's a liability perspective that just says, hey, this is a risk. They could come back and say, I don't like it. And now I've got to pay a whole bunch of stuff. I have a bunch of liabilities as a buyer. So customer contracts, number one thing. In short, we want to remove or reduce consents and assignments. And this is this, a lot of contracts are going to say that, hey, you can't assign this to another vendor or another provider. Well, hey, for most part, when you sign it, that doesn't seem like a big issue until you try to sell the business. If you have an asset sale and you sell the business, assets to your business, that contract's an asset of the business, and you sell it, you may not have the right with the customer to actually sell it without their consent, which means you can't get that transaction done. Again, it's not, comes back to transferability. It's not transferable. So consents become, or assignments become a big issue. Consent also is going to be more of the, hey, you have to get my consent before doing something if there's been a change in the ownership structure. The reason for all of that is just to say that you want to make sure that you have as few consents and a few assignments as possible. It should not be, you don't want it to be standard language in your normal agreement. Sometimes you're forced by your customers to sign their agreement where it's going to have it. You're just going to have to wrestle through it when you get there. But from a legal perspective with customers, that's what they're looking for. Employee agreements.
Employee is the big one, right?
Because in short, there's three elements on the employee agreement. Is non-solicit, which means, hey, sure, I can't hire former employees and can't hire, you know, solicit existing customers, right? That's pretty standard. Non-compete, a lot of companies, I realize that you don't want to make a big issue of it, but the buyers wants to know what's the ability for your team to leave and then to go take what I've bought, right? And the degree to which they have the legal ability to do that becomes a risk. So having good employee agreements is critical. And then probably the one that most people don't have and have overlooked is called rights assignment. So if you've built any IP or you've done any coding or you've created a special secret sauce, if there's not rights assignment, the issue there is, hey, you could sell the business and some employee said, yeah, but I really built that and therefore I should get 20% of the transaction value because I built that. And if you don't have a rights assignment clause in your employee agreements, all of a sudden you can be in a situation where, hey, somebody's going to get a piece of your hard-earned money, right? So having rights assignment is really critical in employee agreements. The other element I'm going to layer across both of those is you need to have a regular rhythm of updating those. An agreement that's 20 years old and every employee is on a different agreement or every customer is on a different agreement just creates a lot of pain. So I would just say you want to update your customer agreements, your employee agreements, usually within every 3 years. So whether that's at a contract renewal, whether that's at a, you know, you give your employee a raise or you give them a new piece of the puzzle, give them some equity in the organization or a profit sharing plan. You want to keep those documents fresh and you want to keep them consistent across the whole segment. So all your employees are on a similar agreement. All your customers are on a similar agreement.
Well, listen, basically, we'll close that piece and get into us next piece that has to do with structuring the deal with the time we have left. However, one thing I do want to ask you, all those things, okay? All those backflips you need to do to get ready and provide all those agreements, whether they're done or not, it's all a question of degrees, right? If I'm buying a company, the best case the seller makes is if, well, the seller has all this information.
Right.
However, for smaller companies, probably don't have the non-competes, right? And right. I'm guessing the only thing I'm saying is that it's a degree that goes into the negotiation or the value of the business. At the end of the day, you still be able to sell your business, but it might be a harder process.
Right. Or here, and this really gets into what we're talking next, which is deal structures, right? In the end, it's going to come back to and say, well, okay, we don't have agreements with all the customers. Hey, we do run the risks with employees. How do we mitigate that? Well, the best way to mitigate that is say, okay, you, Mr. Owner, I'm sorry, but you're going to have to stay on 3 years and you're going to have to take an earn out to make sure that these customers come across, that they don't leave because there's a new buyer, they don't get pissed off. As a result, you end up being the collateral as the owner that has to stay along with the transaction for a period of time with an earnout structure that's based upon the performance of the employee base and the performance of the customer base to be able to get to that number that you want to get to.
Okay, so basically, if you don't have all those ducks in a row, be prepared to basically, have conditions to the sale. You told me last segment, you told me, I think 93% of transactions, listen to this, folks, 93% of acquisitions in the IP space or MSP space have an earnout attached to it for the owner, some sort of, right?
Yep. Okay. But also want to clear the second data point that's really critical besides that is 76% of the time those earnouts pay out at or above expected level. So there's a lot of fear with the earnout that says, hey, this is the buyer. He's going to screw me if I don't do it. Hey, look, the buyer actually wants you to achieve the earnout. The reason for it is that's the best way for him to make sure he gets his money or their money, right? And so good earnouts are really built to be mutually advantageous. It's to the advantage of the buyer. It's to the advantage of the seller to have the earnout. And most of the time it pays out well. I would just say that even in coming through COVID, we've seen the earnout piece become much more forgiving in the sense of going, hey, it used to be, well, because Mark was going, well, we'd expect 10% growth every year. And if you don't hit 10%, then you're not going to get your earnout. Today, a lot of it's just like, hey, we just want to make sure you don't go backwards, right? Yep. And so the earnouts have gotten, I would say, friendlier here real recently, but expect an earnout, especially if you're under $1 million in revenue.
Okay, no, I get it. That's fine. Okay, that's great. So thanks for diving. Listen, I mean, this is complex. Is. This is basically just a discussion, not even a crash course at the end of the day. I mean, we're touching on different subjects. This is great stuff. So listen, we got a couple of minutes left. Let's go to the other part, which is, we can't talk about integration. That just gets like too complicated. And the value from the last discussion, the biggest risk to a transaction going sideways is bad integration or long integration period, right? Because before you're able to make it work to integrate the two elements, right? So, but when it comes to structuring a deal, when everything is ready, okay, and you start talking, okay. Real quick, let's dial back to the approach, the demeanor, who typically makes the first step. And after that, we can talk about red flags or maybe just like walk us through this for a couple of minutes.
Yeah. So, structuring the deal, really in this case, the buyer's going to lead. So a couple of things you're going to need to know as the seller going into, you're going to provide all the financials. They're going to do an initial, we call it a review of the financials, due diligence for the letter of intent. Basically, they're going to look at the financials. They're going to determine a value. And then they're going to come back with, hey, based upon, and they'll want some breakouts of revenue. That's why you want to have those ready. But the point is that they're going to come back with some sort of terms or offer to say, hey, after looking at it, I think this is what we're going to do and how we're going to approach it. They're going to really lead, obviously push back on it. The first offer is never the last offer, all the buyers out there who just hit the panic button on that one. But hey, look, nobody starts with the best offer, quite candidly. So I'm not trying to say push back on everything, but take a look at it. That's not a surprise. But you got to look at it, conversely, again, there's always this, the offer has everything to do with the perspective of risk. And so you're going to have cash at close. You're going to have, so the main levers are cash at close. And I'll talk about escrow as a part of cash at close, but it's cash at close. Seller note is really common. Seller note is where, hey, you as a seller, you're the bank and you're loaning the money and they're going to pay, the buyer's going to pay you that loan back over 3 years, 5 years with interest. It's guaranteed.
Probably happens a lot more in succession planning, right? In succession
It happens. I see it in almost all transactions have it. And the reason for this is the banks are going to come back and are going to say, well, I'm going to only loan you so much money to do a transaction. So how do I bridge all of that? If the seller's willing to take a note, that's good for the bank. But I would just say I really haven't seen other than some situations, and this gets back to cultural fit, where you've got crooked buyers who really are trying to take advantage. Those get paid out. Those are effectively guaranteed. And then you have obviously an earnout, which typically we like to build it upon one of two things. If you're an MSP, recurring revenue is one of the most common ways, and gross margin is the two main levers that are there. Sometimes there'll be equity in the new corp. Don't usually see that in the sub $2 million space where people are going to give equity. But, you know, that can be a part of where they say, hey, we're going to give you 10%. There's some reasons for that. As an example, I might buy you and leave you as a wholly owned subsidiary and do the integration. But then I'm only buying 90% and I'm leaving you 10%. So now we talk about the tax impact of, okay. There's less tax impact because it's only 90%, right? So there's some things there that you'll see from a tax perspective. But those are the main four levers. And on that point, we're usually seeing that guaranteed, so cash and seller note will be anywhere between 50 and 66, so between half and two-thirds of the transaction. The earnouts there to do it. When you get... And again, the riskier it is, the more we see to an earnout. So okay. When we see particularly below like $500,000-$600,000 in revenue firms, there's usually not a lot of agreements. There's not a lot in the way of financials. It's a couple of guys, individuals together kind of working it without a lot of operational maturity. In those kind of situations, you're probably going to get, you might even get 20 or 30% in cash and the rest in the earnout, because candidly, unless the people and the customers stay in the business, there's not a value to the business. And so I think one of the things that I've really wrestled with the smaller companies, and we got done with the transaction here in November on that, the value of your business is not fixed. The value of your business is variable. It's not like a car that I can say, hey, or a house that says, hey, here's the value of this house in the market. The value of your business has everything to do with sustainability of your customers and continued revenue after this transaction. If half of your customers left after the transaction, the value is half of what it used to be. And so the way to ensure that your value doesn't depreciate is you have to go through and you have to earn it out. Unless you can show, and this gets back to some of those other things, unless you can show that, you know what, I have a team in place, they totally run it, and
contracts, agreements in place.
And I can take a month vacation and everything runs fine. Now, if you're in that situation, then everything should move over just fine because the team's coming over and I don't have to have you around for 3 years to guarantee that that's going to happen. But the degree to which you can't do that is how long you're going to have to stay to make sure that value stays with the buyer.
Okay, perfect. All right. So basically, like you said, I mean, listen, if over 9 out of 10 deals have some sort of earnout, it just tells you the volatility and the importance of having that smooth transition. And you know what? As an owner, I'm selling. I can't just walk off into the sun, into the sunset and say, you know what? That's it, right? So if there's no, and I can definitely understand where all of a sudden it becomes in everybody's interest to make sure that this basically there's no diluted value after the transaction.
Right.
And also the integration. Listen, last thing real quick, you know, from your perspective, what are the red flags? Let's say you go into a meeting with either buyer or seller or something like that, or let's say a buyer approaches a seller. And last thing I want to touch on is what type of red flags are you looking for? Like things that tell you, this thing's not going to be easy. Is it lawyers getting into the fold where all of a sudden the guy's got crappy representation that's asking a ton of questions? Is it cold feet from the seller? Is it typically like basically the buyer? We mentioned earlier about the fact of the buyer not necessarily having the level of maturity.
Right.
You know, anything you can expand on that?
Yeah. So a couple of things. I'll skip the lawyer conversation because all I can say is this: if you're going to sell your firm, get an M&A attorney, not just your local attorney, right? And I'm just going to leave it at that. Attorneys are good, but M&A attorneys. It's just, it's a breed of their own, and they know how to make deals and how to make things work that your general lawyer just can't do, or really isn't experienced doing. You know, red flags. So I think a lot of it is one of the biggest red flags for me as I come into that is transparency. If the seller's coming and say, hey, look, here's who I am. Here's what I got. I'll open the books. Yeah, I don't have everything together right. I know I don't have everything together right, but I'm going to be transparent about what I have. That is that's really encouraging to me. Nobody's perfect. And so for the buyer coming into it, it's really trying to wrap our arms around the risk. The ability to which you can't wrap your arms around the risk and it's an unknown. Now I'm going to put more caveats and more concerns and I'm going to escrows and things into it. And so when I have a seller that's just like, yeah, but don't look in that corner and I only want to give you the data that I want to tell you because I want to make sure I look good on it. Okay. That's a red flag. Yeah. Because that now I'm more concerned about what you're not telling me than what you are telling me. And quite candidly, when you take an open book approach, it just said, hey, there's going to be warts, there's going to be stuff. Yeah, we've got issues. I'm happy to talk to you about it. Then the buyer is going to feel comfortable that, hey, I know all the landmines. I've been able to look in all the closets. I know nothing. I realize it's not perfect and I realize there's issues, but I'm not afraid of something jumping out at me. Right. And so I would say that's probably the first big red flag is transparency. You know, the other thing, and I'm just going to tell you it's amazing how many times you get pulled into it, is I'm just going to call it behaviors in the sense of going, hey, let me put it this way. Character is something that's easier maintained than regained. And so when I talk about character, I'm just talking about integrity, how you treat your employees. Do you sue people? Are you on your fifth marriage? Okay. And it's not because I don't want to get into your personal life on that.
I understand.
But it's the ability to be able to walk through it with character and really retain and maintain good relationships with people. And so I've been in the situations where you have owners that really have turned a lot of relationships, that becomes a red flag because you'll tell me the buyer's coming at it going, hey, told me what I've heard. You've told me what I want to hear, not necessarily how it's going to work. And that becomes a red flag. So
what's a good step as a buyer is basically, I don't know, if I have relationships with the suppliers, discreet discussions with trusted suppliers, you've been doing business with that, that person or that business for a long time.
Right.
What can I tell you what? If the guy says, well, you know what, it's always a pain. They're always get their hand out. Okay, like it's not necessarily a red flag, but it paints a picture.
Right.
Okay.
Right.
Okay. So different things. All right. And turnover of employee also. I'm guessing.
Yeah.
I'm guessing a big thing.
Well, so this comes back into cultural fit, right?
Yeah.
And that look, people want to be treated like you know, best way for me to see how you're going to treat me is to see how you treat others, right? In the end. And so everybody has, so nobody's expecting perfection here. And I just want to be really clear on that. That's just one of those nebulous or kind of gray areas that get into it. But usually you're going to respond really, you're going to get a pretty good fit feel within the first, you know, first meeting or two, whether you got good culture fit. And by culture fit, we're talking about employee care, customer care, kind of core values, business philosophies. And again, that just comes to it. If you have somebody that, hey, the only thing that really matters is the bottom line, and you're all about, hey, keeping my team happy, you got a cultural mismatch there. And it's not going to work. And so it's not always integrity issues. It's just, hey, I value things differently. And if somebody doesn't line up to those values, you know, then there's going to be that kind of mismatch and those kind of challenges. And those are the things that you're kind of looking for in those early meetings to say, hey, how well can I get on board with this individual, particularly if you're going to be apart for a longer period. I'm much more concerned about that 3-year horizon now. If you have to come along, how well can you and I work together? And eventually they're going to talk to your team. They're going to talk to your vendors. They're going to talk to your clients and they're going to hear those stories. And really that's going to play into it. Vendors are probably the easiest place to get a backdoor reference. We'll do that. So if I find out that, you know, you're using, you know, Connect Boost or something like that, and I have a good relationship with the guy at Connect Boost, I was like, hey, what's it like working with them? You know, they're going to, well, you know, they'll give you that backdrop thing. And I'm not picking on Connect Boost, or I like Ryan up there, Connect Boost, but all the vendors, you know, have those kinds of things and you kind of take a look at it, but they're also a great referral source, right? If I go to my vendor and I say, what do you think of that? I'm like, oh man, I love working with them, man. They just, here's this, here's that, here's what I like about them. That becomes this great relationship builder. Yeah, it is. And I go as a buyer and go, okay, well, I know that they take care of their vendors, and that's a really important thing to me. And yeah, so I feel comfortable about that. So,
All right. Yeah, you mentioned, I'll leave you with this. A couple of years ago, I was part of a resale of a business, and the owner found his buyer and sold the business and wanted the seller to stay on board. But there was no, I don't think there was any structure with an earnout. They had an employment contract for 2 years, and he showed him the door after 6 months. It was just not a fit. Right? He was trying to build this thing, and you have the owner sitting there, the seller, that's basically souring the everything, right? So, like I said, I mean, once you have an earnout, it's something different. But in other cases, it's kind of like, no. You know what? I thought you'd be help me out to make sure that it was a good transition. Right now, you're not helping at all. So thank you, but no thanks. Stay home.
But and to that end, but it's good both ways, right? And I'm just going to say, because the last thing you as a seller want to do is get into a relationship with a buyer where there's incompatibility. And the same thing's true of the buyer. And so it really is vet that out early on in the process. Mm-hmm. That there's good cultural alignment. It's probably the easiest thing to do. Put it this way, rule of thumb is this: if you wouldn't hire them to your organization, then you probably shouldn't do the deal with them. It's really kind of that simple. If you don't see them fitting in and be a key contributor, even if I'm the seller, right? If I wouldn't hire the buyer's leaders into my organization, that's a great sign that there's a cultural mismatch. And again, I don't want to make it oversimplified because that's a really complicated thing, but that's a good general indicator of it, of do we have good cultural match?
Perfect. Awesome. Listen, man, it's I keep telling myself I have to make these shorter, and we just hit the 1 hour mark. So I'm pretty sure we lost a few people on the way.
Yeah, so no problem.
So listen, this has been great. This is a subject I love. I'd love, you know what, we're probably going to talk again in 2021 for sure.
Sure.
But I want to thank you very much. And guys, reach out. If you had any questions or any thoughts, reach out to Reed. You have the coordinates here. Hey, reach out to me if you want to chat for sure. I'm all about that. And to this, you know what? I'm going to leave you, Reed, stay on board. But before I end the broadcast, I'll end it off with a countdown, because a few of you guys weren't there at the beginning, and because the live feed, the LinkedIn feed didn't work. So I'm going to sign off and wish everyone, listen, we're probably signing off for the next year, right? So everybody.
Happy New Year.
Happy 2021, and Merry Christmas to all, and see each other next year. All right. So bye-bye, everyone.
Awesome. Take care.